Morning. I'm Marc Siegel, professor for film studies at the Johannes Gutenberg Universität in Mainz. And I'm very happy to welcome you to the symposium, Situated Histories, Das kleine Fernsehspiel in the World. A symposium I organized with my colleague in film studies in Mainz, Alexandra Schneider, who will speak shortly, as will our under colleague, Fabian Kling. This symposium is taking place, as you know, within the framework of this wonderful festival, Was Anderes Machen, The Home and the Movie, commemorating 60 years of ZDF, Second German Television Channel's program series, Das kleine Fernsehspiel, The Little Television Play. Alexandra and I were honored to be invited by Bettina Ellerkamp and Merle Kürger to organize this symposium, and we're thankful for the productive exchanges and pleasant collaboration over the past, I think, year and a half, for almost 2 years, with them and with the larger planning team, which included Katrin Brinkmann, Stephanie Schulter-Strathaus from the Arsenal, who will be moderating discussion today, Burkhard Althoff from Klein Fernsehspiel, and a number of others. We'd also like to thank the team here at Silent Green, who've enthusiastically taken on the logistical aspects of the organization, particularly Louise Hoffmeister, who I think all of our guests here have had contact with, but also Marilyn David, or David, I guess, Linda Winkler, and the rest of the staff here, and Richard? Richard, yeah, thank you. We also would like to welcome our speakers and moderators today who traveled from near and far to join us for these critical discussions about the place of Klein Fernsehspiel in the context of transnational and intercultural exchange. And additionally, we welcome all the students from Mainz, Cologne, Halle, and Berlin who are here to join in on the discussions. Our interest over the next day and a half is not only directed at specific film productions and co-productions, but also at the broader framework of geopolitical, economic, institutional, and cultural change within which the tensions and joys of international cooperation take on meaning and value. Hence our decision to expand beyond ZDF or KFS, I'll just say that, Klein Fernsehspiel, to expand beyond ZDF KFS to consider examples from the work of Arte and the Goethe Institute, both of which will be addressed by Rasha Salti and Merv Espina in a final panel tomorrow morning. That Alexandra and I were invited to collaborate on this project has a brief history of its own, which I'd briefly like to sketch, since it explains how we both came to be interested in ZDF Kleines Fernsehspiel professionally within the context of our work in film studies in Mainz. While we each have researched and published about individual Klein Fernsehspiel productions and collaborations, the fact that our place of work is in Mainz, where ZDF is based, has certainly fostered or provided the kind of grounds for an intensified interest in the history and relevance of Das Kleine Fernsehspiel for teaching and research in television and film history, theory, and analysis. This symposium is therefore one stage in an ongoing, multifaceted project of research and teaching about television history as film history and film history as television history, as the title of the master seminar that Alexandra and I are currently co-teaching puts it. A project that we've been conducting in Mainz for about the past 4 years. Perhaps the jumpstart, actually before I say what the jumpstart for this focus were, I should say, I should quote Katrin Brinkmann, who spoke last night and said that her catalyst for looking into the history of Klein Fernsehspiel was came from Merle Kürger. And I have to say that this deepened interest in research and teaching and the possibility of a collaboration with Klein Fernsehspiel in Mainz has also come to us through Merle Kürger when she worked with us in a Mediendramaturgie in Mainz. So we have we all have Marla Kruger, we have her to thank for some of this really important initiative to rethink about opening television archives and thinking more critically about the political, cultural, and scholarly role of Kleine Fernsehspiel. And beyond. I know that Marla's work, of course, goes beyond Kleine Fernsehspiel, but thanks to Marla, we had a jump start for our focus on Kleine Fernsehspiel in the frame of a couple seminars that Marla Kruger taught, one of which together with Katrin Brinkmann, for which students conducted research and practical projects that resulted in part in a number of interesting and informative podcasts, a selection of which are included in the exhibition here. Around this time in 2021, Kleine Fernsehspiel entered a formal collaboration with Film Studies in Mainz, gifting us their internal video archive from the redaktion, the editorial staff, over 2,300 items, including the necessary technical equipment to play the videos in various formats, so Beta, U-matic, for instance. This gift, which we are still in the process of cataloging and organizing, provided the impulse and material basis for subsequent teaching, research, and collaborative projects, which include a number of master seminars, a collaboration with the student-organized Films Festival this year, which just ended last weekend, the director of which is here, and many of the organizers, in which they highlighted queer productions in the history of Kleine Fernsehspiel, and also the encouragement of doctoral research projects. We're delighted and thankful that two of our guests here today, Denise Gürktürk and Gertrud Koch, have agreed to share with us their impressions of the symposium in a final panel on Sunday morning. We highly respect both of you, Denise and Gertrud, as thought-provoking scholars and mentors who have contributed essentially to thinking and reinventing film studies as a site of critical reflection and political and ethical engagement. And we're looking forward to the opportunity of working through some of the threads, bringing together them and the various areas that have been addressed here over the next few hours, today and tomorrow, to think through the possibilities for the future of research and reflection on Kleines Fernsehspiel. And we must also share some unfortunate news. Due to illness, Cecilia Valenti, who's up here on our program, cannot join us today. So we decided nevertheless to stick to our original schedule, although I'm already going longer than planned. But we will react to her absence by including on her panel two longer film excerpts during the time of her panel. So you could stick to this timing, but we'll include a 20-minute selection from Nyuxo Yavu's 1994 autobiographical documentary, Mein Vater, der Gastarbeiter, My Father, the Guest Worker, in relation to the talk by Özgür Çiçek, which will be moderated by Sezen Kayan at that time slot. And after the discussion about Özgür's talk, we will show a 20-minute excerpt from Stephen Dwoskin's Hindered, as background for the talk by Rachel Garfield, which will follow the coffee break. So the time schedule does not change, and we get the pleasure of extended exposure to two further Kleines Fernsehspiel productions in the course of the symposium.
Hello, I'm Alexandra Schneider, also professor of film studies at the Gutenberg University of Mainz. The symposium Situated Histories invites us to explore across six conversations ways of engaging with possible histories of das kleine Fernsehspiel. The invited speakers understand themselves as scholars, curators, and/or artist researchers. They represent different positions and speak about from diverse geopolitical locations and biographical backgrounds. We understand their respective work as timely, pertinent, and productive for decentering film historiography from multiple perspectives, or more specific, For our symposium, we suggest to explore the history of das kleine Fernsehspiel in and off the world. We invited 10 international researchers to present short 15-minute interventions. We hope that with this format of short presentations, we provide room for productive discussions with the panelists and, importantly, with the audience as well. What are the pertinent questions for further research, teaching, and curatorial projects on the interfaces or contact zones that the kleine Fernsehspiel is both part of but also shapes? As mentioned by Marc Siegel, the film studies program at the Johannes Gutenberg University was kindly given the opportunity of housing the internal archive of das kleine Fernsehspiel, a media archaeological collection. With the archive, there also came the list of all the titles that the editorial staff has programmed over the span of 60 years. This list covers more than 2,500 entries for early evening or late night programs, ranging from bought to produced or co-produced films or episodic series that were aired in the context of das kleine Fernsehspiel between 1963 and 2021. Combining these lists into a comprehensive and reliable single list has required substantial research with our colleague Fabian Kling, who has been conducting this project, and he will shortly explain more about it. One fantastic result of this preliminary research, a kind of document of the state of it, is the list that will be placed with other documents in the exhibition. Feel free to look through it to get a sense of the extent of the productions of das kleine Fernsehspiel over the last 60 years' history. It invites for zooming in from a single title, a name of a filmmaker, or a date, to zooming out to a kind of distant viewing. We have prepared this list keeping in mind Anna Zing's critique of scalability as an overarching paradigm for organizing systems, whether world trade, scientific research, colonial economies, or the modus operandi of big studios and platforms. By scalability, Zing means the quality that allows things to be traded out for each other in a totalizing system without regard to the unique or individual qualities of those elements. She suggests that we should look out for non-scalable phenomena and writes, I quote, "The definition of non-scalability is in the negative. Scalability is a distinctive design feature. Non-scalability refers to everything that is without that feature. While scalable design creates only one relationship between elements of a system, non-scalable phenomena are enmeshed in multiple relationships, and relationships are encounters across difference. They have a quality of indeterminacy. Relationships," she also underlines, "are transformative, and one is not sure of the outcome." Please keep in mind these reflections when looking at our list. Now, my colleague Fabian will tell you a little bit more about it.
In the context of a planned PhD project, I would like to present a list in which I'm combining filmographic and broadcasting information of films and series bought or produced by das kleine Fernsehspiel over the last 60 years. This list, this data, can be a starting point for different research designs, processings, or visualizations, which should be the best form for a short keynote on a Saturday. Actually, there are many ways to create graphs, maps, or diagrams rather easily if one has the proper data. As you might be already able to tell, the challenge lies within the proper data part. As John Drucker points out, against the common assumption of data merely existing. Quote, data are made, produced through a process called modeling, unquote. For today, I prepared some preliminary visualizations that address questions regarding transnational entanglements of DKF titles. Though often done with a certain ease when it comes to festival catalogs or databases, for example, we also know that we have to be careful attributing nationalities to films. Films often transgress the national, both in production and reception. So let me briefly guide you to the process of modeling the data into this one comprehensive and reliable single list, as Alexandra called it earlier. I'm trying to show how the information from the ZDF archives are transformed into data, how this data can be visualized to answer questions as well as raise them, and at the end, how even the process of modeling film historic data reveals clues and poses questions at us, at researchers. Our starting point are the broadcast lists we got from the DKF archives. One list, you know, two examples, one from 1963 and one from 2021. These lists included 33 scanned pages from the years 1963 to 1980, as well as 33 Word documents containing a total of 386 pages for the years 1980 to 2021. The first step was transferring all the information into an Excel spreadsheet. While OCR, or optical character recognition, allowed us to copy and paste a lot of the information, even from the scanned document, into our spreadsheet, we had to structure and check the information manually, of course. And as a side note, we are still constantly checking the information manually. Having gathered all the information in our sheet, we are able for a next step of modeling our data. Using the freeware OpenRefine, we refined our data even further. Besides cleaning the data, which basically means erasing or moving insignificant or doubling information, we are able to enrich the data with further information. While the original archive files only sporadically contained information on production countries, OpenRefine allows us to add a lot of this information mostly automatically. This process is called reconciliation and basically links cells to already existing entities in the free and open knowledge database Wikidata. If OpenRefine finds a direct match, it automatically links it. If there are multiple matches, one has to confirm the potential link manually. As you can see, in the title column, the blue titles are matched with Wikidata. The black titles, where it shows new match is written under them, are not matched. As soon as these broadcasting titles were reconciled, we were able to add the country of origin, that's how Wikidata calls it, that Wikidata listed for these productions to complement the data that we already had. There is, however, a catch. Unsurprisingly, not all the productions Das kleine Fernsehspiel aired can be found on Wikidata, which is also shown in this part of the list. And even it can be found, there's not necessarily a country of origin attached to these titles. For our list, which contains 2,869 entries, 1,153 of them were matched. That's around 41%. Which is great. Actually, that's a lot. Luckily, 1,075 of them were attached to at least one country of origin. In total, there were 1,361 entries for country of origin added to our data, meaning there are 1.27 countries of origin per production. Which sounds trivial, but interestingly has the qualities of a numeric testament for the transnational approach Das kleine Fernsehspiel had since the 60s. Again, there's another catch. It's only 41 of the productions that are considered in my calculations. Still, this 1.27 gave me enough to further intensify my research, create even a bigger urge to add more and more production countries to the data. But besides that little calculation, these 1,361 entries of countries of origin allow us to visualize some data with Excel. As you might see, there are some insights and some issues with this graphic. First of all, we see the strong presence of Germany as country of origin. The overwhelming big blue part. Which makes sense, since Germany should be featured for all these productions das kleine Fernsehspiel was involved in. Moreover, we might get an idea of the multitude of different production countries connected to this 41% of the broadcasted productions Wikidata has information on. It's 76 countries, to be precise. At the same time, the countries with less entries get lost visually in this format. Using another tool to automatically project the numbers on a map, the picture gets a little bit clearer. It is maybe self-explanatory, but the bluer and darker countries, or the bluer and darker a country, the more mentions it has in our set of data. The mapping of our data shows the presence of countries from all over the world in the production and programming of this kleine Fernsehspiel over the last 60 years, kind of effectively. But as announced earlier, I want to shed light on another part of modeling film historic data, like those from the archival DKF files, by showing a specific example I stumbled across in modeling and researching the data. In 1965, Das kleine Fernsehspiel showed three films from the Yugoslavian director Vladimir Pogacic: Der Boxer, Der Kuss, and Das Schloss am Anzug. None of these titles got matched with Wikidata by OpenRefine. Furthermore, none of these titles could be found on IMDb, the Internet Movie Database, or any filmographic database I conducted. So I compared the actors mentioned in the archival files with the actors in some of Pogacic's films and came to the conclusion that The Boxer is actually a film titled Subotum Uveche, or Saturday Night, from 1957. After doing the same process for Der Kuss and Das Schloss am Anzug, I got the exact same and at first surprising result. The actors from all three films were matching with Subotum Uveche. Luckily, IMDb, after disappointing me earlier, dissolved my conclusion. Pogacic's film from 1957 contains three segments that were aired separately on different nights under different titles. After searching for similar patterns in our data, it became clear that the practice of buying and splitting international omnibus films was not uncommon for the work of Das kleine Fernsehspiel in the 1960s and 1970s. Of course, it's a presumption to conclude that this practice allowed Das kleine Fernsehspiel to support international filmmakers with more money because there were more broadcasted films, and that has to be confirmed. It would be also presumptuous to assume this was a saving measure, and I guess I go with the first one for now. At least it's a plausible presumption. However, the example of Subotum Uveche shows how the data not only answers, and the process of modeling data not only answers, but poses questions about Das kleine Fernsehspiel and about transnational production practices of a commissioner editor's work generally. Questions that might be answered in the upcoming panels today and tomorrow, and if not, at least open up new perspectives on television and film history.
That's fine.
Now we, yes.
Would you?
We move to our first panel, and I would like to welcome our two first speakers. The title of the panel, actually, Context Zones, I stole of one of the presentations. It's a concept, Context Zones, by the Roman literature scholar Marie-Louise Pratt, who defines it as social spaces where cultures meet, clash, and grapple with each other, often in context of highly asymmetrical relations of power. And I think that's a good catch for the two first presentations. I would like to first introduce the first speaker, Elisabeth Ramirez-Soto. And sorry for that, I have to look through my too much paper. The older you get, the more papers you have in front of you. Just a second, yes. It's really a great honor and pleasure, Elisabeth, that you traveled to Berlin for our little symposium, because I think your research on the kleine Fernsehspiel is really pertinent for our discussion. Elisabeth Ramirez-Soto is assistant professor in the Department of Communication and Media Studies at Fordham University, New York. Prior, she worked in the School of Cinema at San Francisco State University, and her research focuses on feminist film history, transnational film and media practices, and documentary. She is the author, among other books and publications, of Unveiling Bodies, A Trajectory of Chilean Post-Dictatorship Documentary, which was published 2019, and co-editor of Nomadias, El Cine de Marilu Maliet, Valerie Sarmiento y Angelina Vázquez, published in 2016. Her work has appeared in journals like Film Quarterly, Feminist Media Histories, and Jump Cut, as well as in numerous edited collections. She is currently working on a book tentatively titled Transnational Experimental Television, The Global South on European Screens, for which she received a summer stipend from the National Endowment for the Humanities. She is also co-founder of the Latin American Women's Audiovisual Research Network, RAMA. Please welcome with me Elisabeth Ramirez-Soto.
Thank you, Alexandra. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Alexandra, for that introduction. And thank you also for the invitation and to Marc Siegel for I was just telling them that this must be the most exciting invitation that it was that it has ever been made to me. So and thank you also for Luis for coordinating this event. And I am also particularly grateful to Burkhard Althoff for suggesting my name to be considered part of this symposium in the first place. And what I'm presenting today is actually part of this larger book project I'm currently working on, titled Transnational Experimental Television, The Global South on European Screens, which provides a history of the transnational encounters between European public broadcasting and filmmakers from Latin America between the 1970s and the 1990s, the early 1990s, a period of crucial transformations marked by the fall role of revolutionary projects and the increasing dominance of the global market economy. And at this time, the convergence of numerous initiatives within European public broadcasting institutions, such as the Das Kleine, I'm going to say Das Kleine, the ZDF, the INA in France, or Channel 4 in Britain, resulted in the creation of a vibrant cultural space in which television favored experimentation and transnational modes of film production. These national media institutions had specific departments that explored the expressive and political potential of the television medium and welcomed foreign and European filmmakers. Usually located at the margins of their own institutions, these units engaged in collaborative dialogue among themselves and struggled to survive the deregulation and privatization process faced by European media at the time. This period coincided, too, with the arrival in Europe of numerous Latin American filmmakers, often associated with the political film movement known as the New Latin American Cinema. And these directors turned to these broadcasting institutions seeking support to make their films. They found significant allies in these fringe departments, yet these collaborations were not exempt from tensions. These partnerships took place before official international co-production agreements were common and occurred between key players in European broadcasting and Latin American filmmakers in a way that was somehow unruly, flexible, and largely facilitated by the effective alliances and the international solidarity network that the Latin American dictatorships mobilized in Europe and beyond. I see this transnational space of confluence fostered by the encounter between European public broadcasting and foreign filmmakers as a contact zone, drawing on the influential term coined by Marie-Louise Pratt, as Alexandra was reminding us. So following her, I conceived this transnational media space, and I quote her, as a social space where disparate cultures meet, clash, and grapple with each other, often in highly asymmetrical relations of domination and subordination. The idea of contact is useful because while it recognizes the deeply unequal dialogues established between European producers and Global South filmmakers, it also allows me to focus on their interactions, centering on the negotiations and tensions that are at the heart of these encounters. Here, I will expand on the dialogues between Latin American filmmakers and the Das Kleine department. And to reconstruct these broader exchanges, I have done oral histories with a handful of filmmakers and commissioning editors, as well as conducted extensive archival research at the Das Kleine headquarters in Mainz, including accessing the internal production files of the Das Kleine. And again, I'm particularly grateful to Burkhardt for opening this treasure trove for me and for having a lot of patience. Das Kleine emerged with the unusual mission to promote filmic experimentation in television. The department is mostly known as being instrumental in the development of the new German cinema and for financing the early works of renowned European and US directors. Less known, however, is the Das Kleine commitment to promoting the work of Global South filmmakers, although the marvelous initiative that brings us together today aims to redress this situation. Between the mid-1970s and early 1990s, approximately 20 Latin American films were co-produced by the department. At the beginning, even though the Das Kleine did not normally acquire films, they did buy some productions by the then so-called Third World directors, which they deemed important to broadcast, such as the landmark film Chircales by Colombians Marta Rodriguez and Jorge Silva. But very soon the department realized that there was a real need to fund those films in order to get them done. Often, directors could meet the German commissioning editors in international film festivals, such as the Berlin, the Rotterdam, or the Havana film festivals. But a major role was also played by word of mouth, and particularly via what Eckhart Stein called their outposts. The outposts were filmmakers who had already worked with them and who would put them in contact with other filmmakers and so on. For the Latin American case, a crucial figure in this regard was Peter Lilienthal, who, as Claudia Sandberg has argued, facilitated an opening of spaces for Latin American film culture and German screens. This link was a vital one. Only a few months after Pinochet's military coup, it was Lilienthal who managed to get Raúl Ruiz and Antonio Skármeta out of Chile, two key intellectual and artistic figures whom he had met while filming La Victoria, a film that he actually made for the Das Kleine during Salvador Allende's government. It is not surprising then that both Ruiz and Escarmeta ended up making films for the Das Kleine, thanks to this close connection to the department via Lilienthal. It is not surprising either that some of Ruiz's close acquaintances and collaborators, namely his wife, also a director, Valeria Sarmiento, and Edgardo Kosarinski, would also end up making a couple of films each for the German department. Although these films were made under a leftist sensibility marked by European solidarity with Latin Americans who were enduring decades-long dictatorships, the films and videos made for the Das Kleine by these directors were vastly heterogeneous in terms of style and content, and many refused an easy labeling as third cinema or militant films. They dealt with timely topics impacting the region, such as exile, machismo, dictatorial violence, and environmental challenges. These themes, however, were often approached in creative ways in productions that took the form of hybrid films, such as the Brazilian Iracema by Jorge Vodansky and Orlando Sena, innovative documentaries such as Valeria Sarmiento's now feminist classic El Hombre Cuando Es Hombre, made in Costa Rica, or more conventional narratives such as Ardiente Paciencia or Burning Patience by Antonio Skármeta in Portugal. The German slot also funded film school-related projects, such as the one directed by Argentine Carlos Echeverria, called Quarentena, Exile and Rückkehr, or Quarantine, Exile and Return, made in collaboration with the University of Film and TV Munich. Most of these films were co-produced and aired under the Das Kleine slot, Camera Film, which had a strong auteurist mark and which became the strand that most clearly embodied the radical spirit that animated the department. However, even though Das Kleine is famous for providing in Thomas Elsesser's work, Carte Blanche, to its filmmakers, this was not exactly the case with Latin American directors. One of the most important constraints these directors faced was that they were expected to shoot in their home country or at least in their own region. Normally, the Das Kleine would not fund their projects if they were to be made in Europe. This obeyed to a larger policy which had, according to one of the department's commissioning editors, as a, and I quote, decisive criteria when assessing scripts and proposal, the personal involvement of the author with his themes. This implied a demand for, again, authentic images rooted in the countries and cultures these Latin American directors were supposedly familiar with. For the European-based Latin American filmmakers, this was rather frustrating as they were trying to carve a space for themselves within the European film landscape and were in cases unable to return to their home countries due to the complex political context. Another common side of tension stemmed from the fact that the expectations of the German commissioning editors did not often match the expressive and more tangential political discourses that Latin American filmmakers were essaying at this time of political transformations, and which forced them to adapt their practices to new contexts, as the two specific cases I focus on demonstrate. for his film The Sorcerer's Apprentice, Kosarinski, Argentine Dardo Kosarinski, exceptionally managed to transplant the plot from Buenos Aires, as originally conceived, to Paris. In a one-page document, he justified the need to shift the location to the German commissioning editors. In short, according to Kosarinski, setting the film in Buenos Aires could turn the whole project somewhat provincial. Instead, he argued, the plot should take place in Paris, since the city had become not only the preferred place for Latin American artists and writers, but also a center of all kind of, for all kind of exiles and expatriates, including Chilean, Brazilians, and Cubans of every political shade and colorful differences in cultural background. Although the change of location was accepted, the letter exchanged between the Argentine filmmaker and Stein shed light on further tensions around the political dimension of the film. Certain producers of Das Kleine seemed worried of Korsarinski's distanciation from a most conventional agitprop film, a type of propaganda film he explicitly rejected, which delayed the release of the necessary funding to make the film. So here is the film plot very succinctly. The film follows the tribulations of a group of Latin American exiles and their allies whose new life in Paris intersects with the play Danton's Death, about the French Revolution, which one of the characters is trying to turn into a film. And I will show a brief clip of this film so that you can see the less overt political discourses developed by Kosarinski, and also because sadly this film is not being played here in the retrospective, so, you know, how am I not gonna change, show it to you? So this is just a very short clip.
As you can see, this is
a very loaded musical scene that brings together multiple layers of immigration and political violence, where Latin American exile meets the memory of the Holocaust in the streets of Paris. And you can see Os Argonautas by Caetano Veloso, who was also a Brazilian exile at the time, living in Paris. So it's quite loaded. And at the time of its release in 1976, The Sorcerer's Apprentice was criticized for not being political enough, touching only obliquely the state of Latin American politics. And Kosarinski defended himself, stating, and I quote, that a political film is that which poses questions, not that which provides the answers, while he overtly located himself in opposition from a film like the canonical third cinema film, The Hour of the Furnaces. Similar critiques appeared with the release of The Scattered Body and The World Upside Down, also called Utopia by Raoul Ruiz, which he wanted to film in Paris, but he wasn't able to convince the German TV in this case, so he had to end up making in Honduras. Since according to the director, the German counterpart could not appreciate the film's cosmopolitanism. And in Ruiz's account, his idea was to document a group of peasants undergoing a transformation and making them represent different situations of utopian socialism. For example, what would happen if there were no family, property, or nation? But the film that Ruiz ended up making suffered cuts, since, as former commissioning editor Anne Evans recalls in an interview that I conducted a while ago, there were some aspects that they, and I quote her, absolutely didn't understand. Utopia ended up being, in Ruiz's own words, not a film, but a draft of a film. Now, an actual draft of a letter written in Spanish, which I'm not sure if Ruiz ever sent to Stein, further illuminates some of the specific tensions that emerged in this contact zone. Ruiz acknowledged an opacity in the narrative that would make the film difficult to understand to the average spectator. However, Ruiz also seemed surprised with such a critique, as he believed that the Das Kleine had built a reputation due to its openness to experimentation and precisely for not caring for such a spectator. Ruiz's defense of his film is long. It's 4 pages long, a 4 pages rant. But I would like to highlight his defense of the inefficient image, which is alike to that of imperfect cinema. And he writes, this film, the film is made with stains. I guess that these stains deliver an image of inefficiency that I accept and that I feel close to me. I am convinced that our lack of know-how is highly compensated for an excess of nowhere and no why. Know-how would have meant, in this case, not to make the film due to the lack of appropriate budget. Sandberg has described the works directed by Latin Americans for the Das Kleine as having, and I quote her, strong political sentiments. However, I would argue that the opposite was true. The frictions between European producers and Latin American filmmakers derived not only from narrative aspects that were deemed too obscure by the German counterpart, but also due to the more obliquely political and less militant stances that were developing toward social processes, as demonstrated by the critiques raised to the films directed by Kosarinski and Ruiz. Basically, there was a mismatch between the image delivered and the image that was expected, both from and about Latin America, but also from a cinema that had made its global reputation in the 1960s and early 1970s for being politically committed. Indeed, many directors that made films for the Das Kleine occupy a peripheric position within the militant tradition of Latin American filmmaking. To conclude, despite the cultural clashes that emerged from these transnational dialogues, Latin American filmmakers found in Das Kleine a significant ally because they actually shared important traits. They both shared a commitment to combine formal exploration and political interrogation, a creative approach that saw limited funding as an asset and not necessarily weakness, a certain informality in their modes of productions that were at the interstices of industrial and artisanal practices, and a flexibility about contractual agreements, all of which facilitated their mutual understanding. The contact zone fostered by transnational experimental television became a space in which Latin American filmmakers could probe, negotiate, and destabilize an image of Latin America during the 1980s and early 1990s. The films made for the Das Kleine embody the transformation that Latin American cinema was experimenting in its exile as it tried to grapple with the new production conditions and a shifting political landscape with the defeat of the revolutionary projects. Thank you for listening.
Much for this very important and thought-provoking presentation. We will have the discussion of the two presentations together, or the conversation after the second presentation. Thank you very much, Elisabeth. Now I have the honor to introduce the second speaker, Nikolaus Perneczky. He is currently a Leverhulme Early Career Fellow at Queen Mary University of London, where he is working on a postdoctoral project titled Restitution and the Moving Image, Decolonising Global Film Heritage. His most recent publications include an article in Black Camera on the Futures Past of African Cinema in 2022, a chapter in the edited collection Accidental Archivism, arguing the case for restituting Africans' displaced film heritage, and an article in the journal Sources on African archival filmmaking as a practice of restitution. Together with Cecilia Valenti, Nikolaus is currently also working on an edited volume, Restitution and the Moving Image, on the politics and ethics of global audiovisual archiving. He's currently finishing a monograph entitled Against Development, African Cinemas as World Making, and I think it is from this project that he will present us something. Please welcome Nikolaus with me.
Thank you, Alexandra, for the introduction. Thanks to the organizers for the kind invitation to present. You can hear me if I speak like this. Yeah. Yes. Just gonna try this. Okay. I'm just going to time myself. Okay, yeah, and thanks also to Elisabeth. That was brilliant. I think what I have to, what I'm going to present relates to your presentation in many ways. I'm talking about Safi Faye, who was born in Senegal in 1943 and is widely considered the first woman filmmaker from Africa south of the Sahara. And while there are, of course, others before her, she's certainly the most prolific and critically acknowledged female director of the post-independence generation. Like most other Francophone African filmmakers at the time, Faye was tied to the French system of film funding, moving from the 1970s into the 1980s, however, she had to contend with the withdrawal of the French from their special relationship with African filmmakers. In this altered funding landscape, France was offering fewer means to a larger pool of contenders under a new global dispensation, often to the detriment of African filmmakers. And while Faye remained tied to French funds and infrastructure, she also began to look for alternatives. From June 1979, Safi Faye spent a year and a half in West Berlin, first as guest lecturer in ethnology at the Freie Universität, then as a fellow of the Deutsche Akademische Auslandsdienst, DAAD. Between 1979 and 1996, West German institutions provided funding for four of her films. Three of them were co-productions with Das kleine Fernsehspiel. In West Germany, Safi Faye encountered a different model of North-South funding and cooperation, which entailed new liberties and possibilities, but also new constraints. More inclusive and less paternalistic than the French model, it came with terms and conditions of its own. Where do I have to point this thing? Okay. Under a federal court ruling in 1961, German regional and national television stations were charged with providing a platform for all socially relevant groups. This ruling created an opening for Das kleine Fernsehspiel and shaped the program's initial mandate as a springboard for formally experimental and socially engaged works, often by young and relatively inexperienced filmmakers. One main ally of Das kleine Fernsehspiel was the West German cinema of auteurs. Later on, the program granted an exceptional degree of access for women and minoritized groups within German society, but as we've already heard, Das kleine Fernsehspiel equally has a long history of transnational exchanges and co-productions, starting in the 1960s with the new cinemas of Eastern Europe. In the late 1970s and early 1980s, under editor-in-chief Eckhard Stein, there was a marked pivot at Das kleine Fernsehspiel to what was then called the Third World. In a 1982 interview, Stein diagnosed the exhaustion of German Autorenkino and designated as the program's new principal focus Third World films, women's films, and the documentary form. Experimental in its programming, Das kleine Fernsehspiel was equally an economic experiment. It was part of the program's Auftrag, or mission, as defined by its founding editor, Hajo Schädlich, quote, to develop production models in keeping with television's increasingly difficult financial situation, unquote. Responding to a perceived crisis in West German broadcasting, Das kleine Fernsehspiel was proof that television need not be expensive, but also proof of concept for a new model of production. Budgets were extremely tight. In 1986, a fraction of what one mid-sized Hollywood film would have cost at the time had to suffice for a total of 40 annual productions. In practice, filmmakers often forewent compensation for their own labor or drew on personal savings to make films possible on such limited means. Because the level of unionization was low and restrictive union practices virtually absent, much of the actual work could be contracted out to freelancers with pay well below the sector average. Das kleine Fernsehspiel thus served the function of an alibi, as its functionaries liked to say. That is, it allowed the host network ZDF to be seen to fulfill its diversity mandate enshrined in law, while keeping costs low and labor relations flexible. There's a lot of hand-wringing about this in the literature Das kleine Fernsehspiel has produced about itself. And here you can see, in the previous slide, you could see a sample of this. And I'm citing Eckhard Stein, writing in 1986, quote, we penalize freelance contributors for their work, encourage self-exploitation, and often enough, we see ourselves as exploiters when all we want to do is make things possible, unquote. The expansion into new production markets, likewise, was at least in part driven by the fact that it was cheaper to produce outside of Germany. the so-called third world in particular was seen to offer attractive terms for investment. And I'm again citing Eckhard Stein, quote, "The filmmakers are so happy to have even the smallest amount of money, and it is usually enough for them. They don't need actors, they don't need costumes, they don't need huge sums for the unions, they don't really have any obligations like we have," end of quote. Okay, so I'm gonna stop here with the scene setting, the tendential scene setting. We can talk about this more afterwards. I think Elisabeth has also provided some of the context that is important to understand this moment in the late 70s and early 80s, really sort of the threshold of the neoliberal turn, I suppose. But now let's take a closer look at Safi Faye's actual experience working with this kleine Fernsehspiel, which I think will also complicate what I've just said. Much has been written about the films that came out of this collaboration, but to my knowledge, there's no research or anything, nothing that has been written up and published on the production side of things. So about a month ago, as part of a book project I'm working on, I went looking for whatever archival traces I could find of Safi Faye's German co-productions, including in the archive of Das kleine Fernsehspiel. And in what's left of my 15 plus minutes, I will sift through some preliminary findings. As I've already indicated, Das kleine Fernsehspiel co-produced three of Safi Faye's films. Two of them were buy-ins or Kaufproduktionen. One of them was commissioned and entirely funded by Das kleine Fernsehspiel. All three were contracted as Kamerafilme, a new funding and production format, which was unusual in that no calculation or production schedule had to be submitted beforehand, meaning less paperwork, more flexibility, and a greater pace of production, with ZDF providing a flat fee of around 80,000 Deutschmarks, in addition to taking charge of subtitling, in exchange for television rights in the Federal Republic of Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. While most films produced by Das kleine Fernsehspiel did not attract outside investment, and perhaps Fabian would disagree with me on that, it's something I found in the self-descriptions of former editors, Faye's second feature film, Fajal, was jointly produced with additional funding by the Cinema Office of the French Ministry of Cooperation, which was an important enabler of African filmmaking in former French colonies after independence. Also attached to the project was a French producer, Jean-Serge Breton of Z Productions. It was he who originally approached Eckhard Stein at Das kleine Fernsehspiel as a potential co-producer. The French system of film funding required a French legal producer acting on the director's behalf, which forced many African filmmakers into uneven and exploitative partnerships, with many complaining of having been robbed of their work. This was a very common story, and it's exactly what happened here. Faye claims Breton neglected to compensate her for her labor on this film, in addition to outstanding payments from a previous production, and so she put down her foot and simply declined to complete the film. Stein and his colleagues at Das kleine Fernsehspiel were fully aware of the French system of cooperation and its failures, and they self-consciously leveraged Das kleine Fernsehspiel as an alternative co-production model. In the event, they also backed Faye against her French producer. As previously mentioned, the camera film was a means to keep costs low and production schedules nimble, but the looser and less obliging contractual terms also proved advantageous to African filmmakers, specifically when compared to the French system. No external producer, company, or guarantor was required. Filmmakers could simply represent themselves and do their thing with the modest lump sum provided. Knowing of the depredations of the French system, Stein insisted on signing the contract with Faye, not her producer. When Breton failed to fulfill his commitment, Stein pressured him to release Faye from her contractual obligation so that she wouldn't have to resort to a lengthy and costly lawsuit to prove her producer's negligence, something she clearly could not afford. So in this instance, Das kleine Fernsehspiel proved a useful ally. I also want to talk a bit about the way in which FIRE's German co-productions were discursively framed, from the commissioning editor's initial deliberations on the merits of her proposal to the film's presentation and moderation on screen. It's impossible to reconstruct what was said during editorial meetings, but we can get a sense of the positions in play by looking at a piece of paper that was passed around the office, where everyone would note down some first impression and a preliminary judgment on whether or not they want to support a project. And the current editor-in-chief editor-in-chief of the Kleines Fernsehspiel, Burkhard Althoff, has urged me to think of the editor's comments not as the final word in the discussion, but a pointed and often very informal first articulation of thoughts awaiting further elaboration during the actual meeting. So it's important not to present these snippets of opinion out of context, but I do think they can tell us something about attitudes toward non-Western films at das Kleine Fernsehspiel and their transformation over time. So the opinion sheet for Fajal, dated December 1976, is singularly preoccupied with whether or not German audiences will be able to relate. An editorial majority finds the treatment interesting, but many worry the complex subject matter might not really be understood by audiences, who would instead consume the film as merely exotic. There are conflicting views as to whether or not das Kleine Fernsehspiel should fund third world films in the first place. One editor opines, quote, das hat viel exotischen Reiz, aber ist halt doch nicht unser Bier und ein aller Weltladen sollten wir nicht werden. I'm going to leave this untranslated. The same editor moots the costs of subtitling. Another disagrees strongly and makes a principled case for supporting non-Western filmmaking. Quote, I think that we have to get out of the habit of equating Europe with the whole world. An opening to other cultures is urgently needed, even if very few are willing to go there. A third editor recommends the project as a good fit for the series Films from the Third World, which had an explicitly political outlook and took a particular interest in questions of quote-unquote underdevelopment. Fajal indeed seems to perfectly encapsulate these priorities. A portrait of everyday life in the rural village from which Fai's family originates, the film is equally concerned with the history of the region and the cosmology of its inhabitants as it is with their political struggles in the present. At the center of the film lies a critique of agricultural development in Senegal under President Senghor, in particular the state seizure of lands previously held and managed locally. Fajal is first broadcast on the 1st of November 1979. The commissioning editor who accompanied the project took great care to highlight the film's political bent in all framing content, from the program notes to the TV announcement on the eve of the broadcast, while internally reassuring his superiors that Fajal was quote-unquote entirely apolitical in the German sense. So a win-win situation. However, the politicized notion of underdevelopment advanced in the finished film differs considerably from how editors at das Kleine Fernsehspiel conceived of the issue. For Safi Faye, underdevelopment was not a sign of absent or retarded development, but the outcome of an ongoing neo-colonial process of extraction, which simultaneously suppresses alternative developmental resources and trajectories. Her village films, of which Fajal was one, seek to revive what has been suppressed by imbricating the present with the past, linking the villagers' contemporary struggles against state agricultural policy to a long, orally transmitted line of stubborn peasant resistance against inequality, accumulation, and centralized rule. The idea for Fai's second project with das Kleine Fernsehspiel came to her during her time in Berlin. In 1980, when her stint as a DAAD fellow was coming to an end, she approached Eckhard Stein asking for his support on a feature film she wanted to make in Germany. Man sei jai, or Ich, deine Mutter, follows an African student in Berlin, juxtaposing his daily life with letters reaching him from his family back in Senegal. The letters relayed in voiceover are the actual letters Faye received from her mother and father after she had moved to France. But the male protagonist's trials and tribulations are his own, with Faye merely tracing his steps and cast of mind. In an interview she gave to the radio station RIAS, Rundfunk im amerikanischen Sektor, she explained she was driven to portray the lives of these students because hardly any films existed about African presences and experiences in Germany at the time. The editor's opinion sheet, dated 14th of March 1980, is awash with endorsements. The project's intermingling of actuality and fiction, its focus on a marginalized and underrepresented population, and the fact that Faye was by now a known figure at this kleine Fernsehspiel all recommended her proposal. It probably didn't hurt that several editors were reminded of Chantal Ackermann's critically acclaimed News from Home. And while I don't know what happened in the actual meeting, judging from this opinion sheet alone, this may well have been a unanimous vote. Mansayai was produced with ZDF monies alone and on an incredibly tight schedule within the space of a few months in the summer and autumn of 1980. Funds were to be released in increments at designated stages in the process, but then got stuck in bureaucratic limbo as administrative procedures in the larger organization were lagging behind the speed of production made possible by the camera film model. As commissioning editor Annegret Even complains in an internal communication, it took an entire month for the document authorizing the production to pass through all the official channels. Like Fajal before it, Mansayai was shown as part of the series Films from the Third World. In her treatment, Faye describes migration as an effect of uneven development, an important aspect of which was the creation of a third world within the first. The text of this initial treatment later served as the template for the German program notes, almost word by word. However, where Faye speaks only of Africa and African migrants, the editor slips in the term Schwarzafrikanisch or Black African, drawing our attention to the director's racialized identity as locus of enunciation. And my point is not to criticize das kleine Fernsehspiel for having recourse to language we now find problematic, but to highlight the work this language does in framing Faye's films for broadcast on German television. The text of the Anmoderation or TV announcement likewise emphasizes not the film's immediate concerns but the identity of its creator, playing on the idea that the roles are reversed. For once, an African filmmaker is looking at us. It all sounds like a rematch of Jean Rouge's famous reverse ethnography, Petit à Petit, which incidentally featured Safi Faye in a main role. But I don't think Rouge is really the point here at all. Rather, the TV announcer's riff on the reversal of the gaze was an attempt to build a bridge, offering a point of identification for an assumed white German audience, albeit as object of the gaze, when in reality this wasn't a film about them, about us at all. So put differently, Mansayai was presented in this way in a concession to the belief that German viewers, absent such an anchoring in their own racially defined identity, might not care to look at all. And so I think what both these framings show is that in this instance, at least, the editors at das kleine Fernsehspiel were lacking the courage of their convictions. The abiding concern that viewers might not relate to the film or only relate to it superficially as exotic curio paradoxically produces more of what it seeks to avoid, the filmmakers and the film's exoticization. Mansayai was broadcast on the 4th of November 1980. In the protocol of the telephone service of that day, which was manned by an editor of the program, just one caller is recorded. And while his statement may not be representative, it confirms the editor's worst fears. In a foul mood, he complains about factual inaccuracies, though he declines to specify what they are, and states his frustration at being made to watch films by and about foreigners. Film hat nichts mit Realität zu tun, viele Aussagen stimmen nicht, Anrufer wird noch gegen die Aussagen des Films vorgehen, kennt sich in der Szene aus, hat es satt, immer nur Filme über Ausländer zu sehen, werden überbewertet. End of quote. And so I'm just going to give you a last quote, and then I'm gonna end my talk. In an interview at the end of her stay in Berlin, Safi Faye sums up her experience in West Germany at the beginning of the 1980s in terms that echo the experience of Mansayai. The loneliness she observed among African students in Berlin, she says, has persuaded her to seek a livelihood for herself and her daughter Zaiba in Senegal, at least while her child's personality was still in development. Quote, "It was not the winter cold that made me shiver here in Germany, but the cold between people." End of quote. And I'll have to end here and skip the famously contentious and drawn out production of Mossan. It's a fairly well known story, except for the central role Eckhard Stein and the ZDF played in this 7 year long drama. But I can say more about this in the conversation if you like. This is all I have time for today. Thanks very much for listening.
Please have a seat also. Thanks a lot, Nikolaus, and I feel very bad that we do not have more time to listen to your research, both of you, because I think you're really onto something which is really needed to put in more in a conversation. This very complex relationship between commissioning, editing houses, and filmmakers. And I think this opened up really important and, well, fascinating is not the right word, but really important context. Before maybe opening up to questions of the audience, I would like to know from both of you how I think you did not know about each other's research before. Of course, it's also not yet published. So, but how do you relate the findings of your respective, it's not only case studies, but workings to each other? How would you summarize relate it, because it's a different continents. We can see a lot of similarities, but maybe there is also differences or something you can now learn from each other.
Sure. I was very taken with your presentation and I very much look forward to your book, which I'm sure will appear before mine. So I'll get my hands on that. And I think our concerns really chime in many ways. But the thing that perhaps strikes me the most is this question of periodization. Because there's a moment, I thought you were also sort of hinting at this in your talk, in the late 70s, early 1980s, when these television stations become important funders for filmmaking in the global south, sometimes stepping in where others are withdrawing, as I indicated in relation to French funding for African cinemas, which both opened up new doors, but also, as I said, brought new conditions, not new conditionalities, new problems. And I, in my book, which is mainly concerned with the post-independence period, which is also often characterized as the age of development, when state-led development was the name of the game. The Safi Faye chapter serves to take this story beyond this period into the beginning of the of the neoliberal era, for which the African continent, of course, was the initial laboratory with the structural adjustment. And I'm looking at, I'm interested in like how that is reflected in film funding, in co-production, but also in the films themselves, how the filmmakers themselves deal with this transition. And I felt like there's maybe some resonances there.
Yeah, I mean, I thought that it was very interesting this, right, because one of the things that fascinate me about these productions is that they kind of they are floating in the air, right, as though they are not, they did not emerge from anywhere, right, like these are auteurist films that have no origin of production, right, so there are articles that examine, you know, the textual, the artistic, aesthetics characteristics of these films, but we know nothing about the mode of productions, right? So that's what I also found interesting about your talk, that, you know, how were these films made? Like, who was crazy enough to fund these films, right? That's kleine. So that's how I started, you know, like, oh, what's the origin of these films? Where did they get the money to do this? And also what I would like to talk to you maybe, you know, afterwards, it's about like the issue of methodologies, right, and of access of sources, because to do this kind of research is not easy, right? We're not just looking at the films, right? Some of these films can now be found on YouTube, right? So that's not really the focus. The focus is like accessing documents. So opening up the archives is not just digitizing films. That's an important part of it, but we also need to access documents, right? Like what you said, no, like this, I mean, I wasn't lucky enough to find these records of how these editorial decisions were made, right? Like for instance, for the most contentious ones, I would say like, it would be like the film by Raul Ruiz, no, which is kind of an important, a very emblematic film funded by Das Kleine. There are no production files for that film, right? I couldn't see it, right? But there are other records for other films. So it's important that, like, to find those archival traces that inform us so that we can make sense of these films, and particularly these tensions of the contact zone. Yeah.
Thank you. And apart from a lot of things, I think we will start calling, das kleine Fernsehspiel, das kleine from now on. I really like this expression or concept. But I would like to give also you in the audience the opportunity to ask questions, the two presenters, because we have, I think, a good 10 to 15 minutes max left for our conversation. It's probably not too early, but too overwhelmed with what you extracted from both archives, but also did reconstruct in oral history. I mean, you mentioned, maybe I can follow up your issues on methodology, and you both used the notion of traces. So you used different traces you found, and of course, traces always implies that there are also documents missing, but also traces missing. Maybe you can say something more about the oral histories you did with both maybe filmmakers and commissioning editors, if I understood correctly, and yes, and also you afterwards, Nicole.
Yeah. In my case, I have mostly so far interviewed Chilean filmmakers, but I plan to interview, to have a conversation with Jorge Bodansky, who I'm very excited that I will have the chance to meet for this event. I have also, I was lucky enough to talk to Annegret Evans before she sadly passed. So I was very grateful, you know, Burkhardt put me in contact with her. So I had a chance to talk with her about her own experience working as a commissioning editor and as being, you know, the Eckhart Stein right hand. So that was great. Unfortunately, I was not able to interview Eckhart Stein. He had already retired. But because this, what I presented now is part of a broader project, I have been talking and also accessing documents from other slots like the Das Kleine. You know, I interviewed Alan Fountain also before he died, so because I've been working on this for a long time. This is slow research, and I'm also a slow researcher, but this kind of work is difficult to do, right? It takes time. It takes time to get people to open these archives, right? These are not exactly archives, right? Like, I remember when I first approached Burkhardt, you know, these are not archives. Right? These are internal files. So how do you deal with this file? That's a challenge, you know? How do you deal with it? How do you make sense of them? Yeah? So that's why you have to complement, to complete, also to supplement, you know, when there are no archival traces, you supplement this with oral history, yeah? And also you speculate, yeah? Where is that production file of Utopia? What happened with that? I remember that Anne told me that she kept the how do you say, the can, the film can of the film that was cut or censored in her office for a long time. And then I don't know what happened with that can. You know, where is that part of the film? I don't know. It would be great to find it.
Do you want to add something?
In my case, it was fast research. I haven't done any oral history on this part of the project in any event. As I've mentioned, this is part of a larger book project, and the rest of it I've written some time ago, really. And the idea to bring in Safi Faye is more recent, and as some of you may know, she sadly passed away earlier this year, and I don't quite know how to talk about this, but I just felt it would somehow be quite inappropriate to try and access her personal archive at this stage. It is in very good hands, I think, of a French film curator and researcher who has been commissioned, I suppose, by her daughter Zaiba to look after these materials and eventually to make them available. I have been in conversation with her, but I just feel it is inappropriate. So the question was initially, can I write this chapter mainly by recourse to the traces that Safi Faye left in institutional and other archives elsewhere? This was kind of a first test of that hypothesis, I'm optimistic now that it is possible, but it will be in some ways a truncated history that I'm able to tell, and somebody else in the future will have to tell the whole story.
Thanks. We have two questions in the audience, if I may. Ask them, Alejandro first.
Both of you just emphasized the importance of documents and kind of also put them a little bit into opposition to the importance of the films being archived and being accessible. And I wanted to ask you if in your research there was an instance where, from after looking at the documents and finding out certain aspects about the production process, something in looking at the films changed. Obviously it did, but would you say there were really moments within films where you said, I look at this differently now that I know of the process? Where these processes that you uncovered in looking at the archives were actually maybe even referred to in the film or something like this? Was there an instant?
I don't recall like a moment of illumination like that. I do remember, you know, seeing Utopia, the first time, and it was like, what is this really weird film? Like, it doesn't make any sense. But reading the documents, you know, you start and you understand, you know, like the goal, the purpose, what was going on, you know. But I don't, I mean, really, for me, the films are secondary in this case. And it's interesting because I never thought I was going to say something like that. But like that, I've become obsessed with ancillary materials and how much they can tell us about the films themselves. So definitely they enrich. I guess that's why I don't have like this aha moment when watching the films, because they get just so much richer with all this information and the documentation that surrounds them, all of them, every single one of them.
I think I'll answer very generally, but I'll can tell you, I can give more examples afterwards. I would say yes, definitely doing this kind of research and taking this kind of approach to the films and filmmakers that I'm looking at has just informed my understanding of these films as testaments to their struggle in a capacious sense, and to think of their practice as a struggle which you can see in these films in various ways. And I love the Ruiz quote about like the know-how and the know why and the know where, and I think it shifts the emphasis to these questions. Yeah.
Thanks. There is another question in the audience, or
a remark. I want to thank you very much for this critical view on the practice of this time, and I think it's very important to that there's a certain tendency to a hagiographic view of the department, and on the other hand, I think it's very interesting to point the blind spots of this practices in that time also. And I think it could be very interesting to dive deeper into the question of what is the self-image, the leftist self-image in a certain time of Europeans or German inside, one has to know, inside a very conservative institution also. There are a lot of relations that influence this whole process and practice. And regarding the question of production files and how they can help to read films, I have to say, I think sometimes these production files don't include the important information, but sometimes you have information that make clear that certain artistic decisions have very practical reasons. And because film is such a complex and economically driven art, knowing these files and knowing some circumstances help you to not misinterpret certain films. You know, if you say, oh, the reason for this is that and that, and then you learn it can be very banal, you know, why a certain location or decision has been taken. And I think also in this looking on a practice of the mid-70s, mid-80s, I think it's also interesting, it could be interesting to look what's the practice of festivals, inviting which films, and what this did to, what was the self-image of programmers at this time. I think there's something more to find. Yeah, thank you.
Would you like to pick that up and say something?
Well, just on the point of festivals, you mentioned the outposts as important to the creation of transnational networks, and this was a very informal process, right? Like who gets to to know who gets introduced to Eckhard Stein, and I found Safi Faye also tried to bring some of her friends into the fold, Raoul Peck, Jibril Diop Mambetti, and Jean-Pierre Dikonge Pipa, different filmmakers whom she introduced to the editors. That's an interesting aspect of this as well, I think. Also, thank you to Burkhard Alter for so generously hosting me and you as well, I suppose. And
thank you for the generosity and for the trust.
Yes.
But I think what really becomes clear that there is a lot of not only negotiation, but really difficult kind of conflict-driven negotiations going on in the process of the films, at least you described, that were made. And in order to reconstruct that, I think it's really maybe really necessary and really an imperative to also try to find traces of production and not only of the films themselves. There is one time for one more question. It's very difficult, sorry if I look like this, a bit grumpy, but blinded by the lights. Oh yes, Dennis Göktürk, please.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed both presentations, and I thought, you know, so the title of this symposium being Situierte Geschichten, Situated Histories, you know, you really both drew our attention to the situating work that Das Kleine has been doing, right? You know, so, or should, maybe we should say also the labeling, categorizing and fixating work that the commissioning editors have been doing. And in that context, I was really interested in, Elisabeth, you were talking about funding criteria. And, you know, that one of the funding criteria was the familiarity of the director with their theme, right? So that also came up in Nicholas's presentation with, you know, sort of the question, will German audiences be able to relate? So, you know, so were these funding criteria, you know, I'm interested, were they spelled out and were they, How were they enacted in the decision making, and then also the geographic situation that takes place? You know, who belongs where, basically.
Yeah.
And that question also, you know, arose for me with Fabian Kling's, you know, elaborate data, you know, visualizations when he was sorting films by country of origin. So I immediately thought, okay, what about co-productions? You know, sort of where do they fit in the scheme? But you know, so yeah, you got my gist.
Do you want to go first, or
I can? And we just have about 3 minutes.
Yeah, I will keep it short, but we can talk about this later. But I mean, this is really what was a challenge for the Latin American filmmakers, right? Especially for the ones who were in exile, because, for instance, Valeria Sarmiento had to film her film, the two films that she made for the Das Kleine. One was in Cuba, and another one was in Costa Rica. And she's originally from Chile, but she was exiled in France, right? So, and Cuba and Costa Rica have nothing to do with Chile, right? Like, really, nothing. So it's like, you know, but then that, okay, Latin America, okay, let's send her, like, it doesn't matter, yeah, right? So, and then she also made a film about Mexico, about the Mexican border for the UK. So this was not only expectations from the Das Kleine, but from European, this European mindset, right? So she responded with self-exoticization, right? So like, okay, they want something exotic, like, I can give you something exotic, you know? So she was playing, they were playing with this, right? And the films that she made are magnificent. right? And very uncanny, right? Because they have this distance, right? Okay, I'm from Latin America, but this is a culture that is completely different from mine, right? We come from the Andes, right? We have nothing to do with more Central Caribbean realities. And Ruiz ended up making the first Honduran film, right? This was the first film that was ever made in Honduras. So also, again, nothing to do with the Chilean culture that they were familiar with. Yeah, so that's interesting. How do they also negotiate and approximate these other cultures? These are other cultures for them too. Yeah, that's what I can say.
Quickly, in view of the time, on the question of funding criteria, I mean, I think that there were such criteria at any given time, but from the various brochures and self-published books that I've looked into at the at ZDF, it appears to me that there was a great resistance to actually spelling out any binding sort of set of criteria, and there was a sense that that would sort of lead to ossification, and that was the big enemy. So there was a desire you find often expressed to keep things fluid and moving.
Thanks to two of you for those wonderful presentations.
Thank you.
Thank you. We will